gentlemen. If I could have your attention, please. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now that time that I have the distinct pleasure to welcome to the stage for the Getting to Know OpenSDP session, Miss Miriam Greenberg, Jared Knowles, and Lauren Durr.
Thanks, Robert. This is like you never, if you have a Robert, you will always appear great in front of other people. So, good afternoon, SDP Network. We are in the home stretch of convening, and so while Tom Kane will close the event at 2:45 today, I want to take this particular moment to say thank you to my staff and to everyone here who presented, who shared their expertise with someone else, and who gave their all in making this convening great. So thank you very much. You all deserve a round of applause. So now it's the time to talk about that thing that we've been like building momentum up for this entire convening. So can I get a drum roll, please? OpenSDP! So prepare to be underwhelmed. is what I'm actually trying to tell you. Usually when you have like a big product launch, it's like this really bright, shiny thing, like the new iPhone 7 Plus, like you hold it up and it's like brilliant, beautiful, rose gold glory.
Brilliant, beautiful, it's great.
Woo! Thank you, Kate. Or like the Snapchat store is like this giant yellow monolith on Fifth Avenue, and you don't know what they sell, but you are still impressed by it. Or like something very innovational, transformational, like Google Glass, or actually, scratch that, not Google Glass, that did not work out very well. But you get the point. When you roll out a new product, it should look terrific. It should be the shiny new thing, the panacea to all problems. And I have to tell you, like, I am not Steve Jobs. I do not look good in a turtleneck. And this is not that. This is not that. This is the kernel of an idea. It's the bones, and I think pretty good bones, but the bones of something great that we actually want you to co-own. And that's this thing called OpenSDP. So we're going to share a little bit about what that is with you today. And I'm joined by my wonderful team here to tell you a little bit about it. But I first wanted to talk a little bit about, like, two pathways, equally valid pathways to how we got to this place here. So these are gonna be like origin stories. So in the beginning, there were education analysts, and they lived all over the country and worked on very similar problems. Some of them were very talented education analysts. All of them were SDP fellows, and then there was everyone else. Everyone is a talented education analyst, but they were all like in reinventing code to solve the same problems. Very few of them checked to see if someone else had already written an analysis or a model or a set of code with someone across state lines to see if they could do it faster or better. Very few of them pressure tested it on their own teams to see if their code was any good. But everyone was kind of like creating the wheel anew. There were also education researchers, doctoral students, esteemed economists of education, of which I work for a few, and all of them were churning out these amazing analyses for school systems about what works and what doesn't work and why and what the problem is. And then they would go to publish and they would share the findings forward, but not how they got the findings, which means that school systems can't actually reproduce those analytics year over year to see what's changing or how things are going. So those code like end up locked up in the ivory tower. And then finally, there are foundations, nonprofit organizations, who are measuring interventions that are happening in school systems because they believe they will be better for kids. And those folks, too, are running these codes, running these analyses to measure their impact in the world and not really sharing that with a lot of people. And so in that way, we have actually quite a closed system, right? And so all of the education analysts, the researchers, the nonprofit and foundation program officers sort of shook their fists to the heavens, and they said, we need a solution to make this easier and better. Who's done this before us? And then a very fatherly voice came down from the heavens and said, you know, sometimes other people's ideas are better than your own. And if you surround yourself with people who challenge and inspire you, then maybe you'll get better faster. That was my father's voice. Yeah. For those of you who were here a couple days ago. And so it was. And that is the origin story number one of OpenSDP. Here is another version, another more practical version of how we got to this place. So many years ago, at our origin as an organization, we thought, like, let's free data analytics. Let's make this really accessible to as many people as possible. So the Gates Foundation funded us in building a pretty incredible set of tools called, we call it the SDP Toolkit. We have two. We first built the College Going Toolkit. It's awesome. It's still awesome after all these years. And we made all that code available to districts and states. And it was, by and large, very successful. So we decided to build a second one. We built a human capital toolkit that we started to train fellows in both of these different toolkits so they could use those to make a change in their agencies. And we saw actually some big impacts on policy and the way that districts and states use data because of these tools. But eventually we saw a couple of things happen. The first thing was that, like, we just put it up on our website. We're like, here, free, everyone will come. If, as Lisa said earlier, like, if you build it, they will come. And then we saw website downloads start to drop over time, right? And then we started noticing that our fellows were really savvy, and as we would put them through the routines of the toolkit, they started to identify bugs, inefficiencies, like new things that they could actually do with the tools we gave them, but they had no way to get them to us, to raise up those issues and improve the toolkit. So it was like the static resource, right? That couldn't go anywhere, and all the brain trust, all the like evolving expertise in the field was sort of outpacing the toolkit itself. So we saw those fixes and gap areas. And then the last thing we saw is, like, fellows started to work on different things, right? They started to work on teacher prep, discipline, disparities, all kinds of things in the field. And we found that very exciting and had to ask ourselves, like, can we serve those people, right? So last year at Convening, we ended Convening, for those of you who were here and remember this, we ended Convening by asking you, like, what is Diagnostic 2.0? Like, what's the next big toolkit we should roll out? And we all got together after we did that, and we sat down with all of your answers in like a giant spreadsheet to see like what questions are people interested in, what analytic tools should we develop for people. And the list was very large and varied in like the way the different tables approached the question. And we realized that, like, do we have this expertise? Isn't someone at another university or another school or in an agency already doing this work maybe better than we could? And so we also had that moment of asking ourselves, like, are other people's ideas already ahead of us? And how could we leverage that as a community and as a network in order to figure out what we do next? So that night, this man came to me in a dream. Does anyone know who this man is? This is not my father, that's a hint. Economists? Ah, finally got you. This is, what? Ah, close. This is Robert Coase. Robert Coase is a famous early 20th century economist. He is famous for asking a really important question in economics, which is like, if markets are so great, why do we have organizations? Like, why do we have firms at all? Why do we build these like institutions and organizations if we can just offer our services and then let like markets and contracts take care of all the willings and dealings? And he observed something, which is like, actually, it's really hard to find people, figure out what they offer, and make a deal. So what firms and organizations do is they like help lower the transaction costs, right? I know this sounds way out there, but bear with me. So in other words, like, in order to like incentivize group effort or harness group effort, firms kind of lower the transaction costs to do business together. right? So since he published that article in the 1930s, like, we've always known that there's kind of a Coasean ceiling. We've always known that there's a Coasean ceiling, which is like, there is a point at which firms or organizations get too big. Like, the costs of having an organization can, like, cause the organization to fall apart. This happens to giant conglomerates, right? But now in the 21st century, I think we're at this point with the internet where we know actually that there's a Coasean floor. We're just beginning to kind of uncover that. And this is the point at which, like, a group could get together to produce something of value, but it doesn't make sense to build an institution around it. And a good example of this is an encyclopedia. There used to be a point at which it made perfect sense for an organization to publish encyclopedias and disseminate them and sell them. It no longer makes that sense because literally everybody is doing that for free, right? So the way in which, like, there are things happening beneath the Coasean floor makes the way that we do business different, and it also, like, allows us to scale a lot faster. So Ronald Coase came to me in a dream, and even though he had the voice of my father, he made me ask this question, like, could we harness this idea of open in order to address that problem that we face as an organization, which is, like, how can we leverage all of the talent and code that already exists in the network and help everyone kind of share it with one another? That's it. It was that simple. Can education, like data analytics, go open? That was the question. So we're going to try. And like Lisa said earlier this morning, like, this is our alpha. So, like, don't hold us to it if you don't love it right off the bat. Like, we just built this thing very scrappily in the past few months. And I really do want to thank a few people, like Lauren Dahlin, first of all. Lauren helped make this thing beautiful, built these tutorials that, like, lie beneath it that are, we hope, are going to be really valuable for you. Jared Knowles, who is our SDP, a longtime SDP faculty trainer and advisor, he helped build some a really important part of what this is. Meg Nipson, who is ill and should not be here today, but she showed up and she really helped manage this project to its conclusion, including, like, bringing along all these amazing analysts on the team, even though they're not supposed to be technically working on this project, got them to do it. So Sidra and Marina, thank you so much for your help in building this thing. We're just a scrappy, yes. So they put this together, and what we want to do today is, like, share it with you, show you what it is, what it does, walk you through some, like, possible user stories that we thought of, and then kind of give you the reins to give feedback. So we'll walk you through, like, a process for giving us feedback. You're, like, our beta community. In fact, like, you're the co-owners of this thing, so we really want to get your feedback about how you would use this, if you wouldn't use this, why, what would make it even better, what we haven't thought of yet, and I'm pretty sure there are some cool things, like very futuristic things we could do with this thing. So we want your feedback on what's next so we can start to build it out. There's already enough bones there to make it, like, we've already put the legwork in to make this substantial enough that we hope it's of value. We're going to use it as a training resource. Like, it's there, it's here to stay, but, like, how can we make it super useful to you? That's the question. So with that, I am going to turn it over to Lauren to start to walk you through what this thing is.
Great. Thanks, Miriam. So as Miriam said, my name is Lauren Dahlin, and I was one of the developers on the OpenSDP project. So, you know, one of the components of the project is that we're sharing code on GitHub. But all of that code is essentially worthless if we can't actually run it on our own computers because the data is not data that can be shared with everyone. So I think a major question for us as we were going through the process of developing OpenSDP was, how can we collaborate on these analyses in education when we work in closed data environments? Raise your hand if you work with student-level data that can't be shared with other people. Right? That's almost everyone in this room. So how are you supposed to send your code to someone else and have it run in their machine if they can't actually use your data? So we've come up with three different ways that you can do that. Of course, you can use publicly available data, but as you all know, that data is not usually at the same level at which you're doing your analysis. Usually we're running our analyses at the student level, so we want our data to also be at the student level. The second way that you can share your data and allow people to run your analyses is to create synthetic data from your actual data. And I'm not going to go too much into the specifics of how you do this, but if you're interested, please contact someone on our team and we can provide you with some resources on how to do that. Then the final sort of way that you can share data is by using our synthetic data generator. And this is one of the cornerstones of the OpenSDP project, was that we created essentially software in R that will allow you to create fake data on which you can run your analyses. I'm going to let Jared speak more to the specifics of that, but that's just a preview of one of the main things you can do using the work we've done here at OpenSDP. So another component of our project is that we wanted to make the analyses that were coming from the college-going toolkit and make them more usable, accessible, and more easy to collaborate on. So just for those of you who don't know this toolkit super well, it's basically a set of descriptive analyses around college-going that will tell you about how your agency is doing in sending high school graduates onto college and then how well they're persisting through 2 years in college. So it generates a series of graphs from code that we've written here at CPR. So we took that code, we ran it with our data from the synthetic data generator. And then instead of having sort of traditional output from Stata, which is just graphs, we had it output instead these really very accessible and shareable HTML files that are just web pages that you can share with anyone. So we're inviting all of you to help us improve the toolkit, add new analyses, and use our synthetic data to do really cool things in the area of college going. And then a final component of OpenSDP that we've been working very hard on is our tools and tutorials. And this is something that's particularly dear to me because, as you all know, it's really so hard to get started working in education analytics, and it's so very helpful when you have the tools and tutorials that other people have written to help you make that jump into a new analytics space. So we've developed some tools that you can actually use right now to help you learn new things and sharpen your analytic tools. The first is a series of modules in both Stata and R that will help you learn to clean data better. The second is my R Shiny and Plotly tutorial, which some of you got to preview yesterday, so thank you so much for being my guinea pigs on that. And this is teaching you how to make interactive data visualizations using R. So we're very excited about this. And finally, we've provided some templates in both Stata and R that are going to help you organize your work better and use this new technology where you're outputting web pages instead of traditional output that's hard to follow. Now I'm going to turn it over to Jared, and he's going to talk more about our synthetic data generator and some user stories.
Thank you, Lauren. So I don't know if many of you know me, but when I got involved with SDP, people always say, "Oh, you were a fellow, weren't you?" And I said, "Actually, I was never an SDP fellow. I, one day, was sitting in a hotel in D.C., and I was looking, somebody had mentioned, oh, you should check out this thing called the College Going Toolkit by this group called the Strategic Data Project. So I was like, wow, that sounds really cool, because I'm trying to do a college going analysis with NSC data in Wisconsin right now. This was in 2012, and I looked at it, and it was in Stata, which broke my heart, because if you know anything about me, I'm R evangelist, and I didn't have the money to buy Stata at the Wisconsin SEA at the time. So I immediately sent off an email to the director of SDP at the time, Patty, And I said, you know, this is so cool. I'll convert this whole thing to R, and it would just be really great, and then everyone can use it. And she was like, that sounds great. Why don't you fly out to Boston and come to one of our meetings and get to know us? And then that started our relationship together. But I never actually did the conversion to R until this year, because we never could really figure out a way to share that material out with people very easily, and the editorial process was going to take forever, and we're going to make these PDFs, and I couldn't make them look the way the Stata ones did. And so what I'm excited to tell is, like, from my beginning of involvement with SDP to now, like, this is the vision that I've always wanted to see SDP be able to allow, is analysts to participate in a very low-cost way. And technology has made that a lot easier in the intervening 5 years. So that's one thing we want to take advantage of. And so the idea of participating is that for you out there, you have great ideas, you're doing interesting analyses, and you're doing interesting work, but there's strong barriers to your participation. And one is being able to produce the output in a way that other people can consume, and another one is to have a way to share your analysis where you don't feel like there's any confidentiality issue. Both of those are really big problems. And so Lauren talked about the part about how if you use our templates, you're going to be able to share things through GitHub, make a nice, attractive-looking web page that guides you through your analysis. And then they assigned me the thorny problem of figuring out how are we going to deal with this confidentiality issue. So the thing is, the most interesting stuff you do is with confidential data. The stuff you'd really like to show off, and the stuff where you'd really like to learn from other people. So when I thought about this problem a few years ago, I first built a really bad synthetic data set at the student level. And it was like, I made like 300,000 students, and then I gave them random test scores, but the test scores weren't linked to anything. So when I did any analysis on it, it didn't look like real data. It was clear that these students were artificial and the analyses were uninteresting. So if I shared it with somebody with synthetic data, they'd say, that's really boring, Jared. This doesn't look like anything interesting. There's no achievement gap in your data. There's no growth in student achievement. There's no tie between economic status and achievement. And so I thought about this problem a lot, and Miriam, when she asked me to get involved with OpenSDP, I said, I think we really want to make synthetic data that's realistic. And so I think we have done that to an alpha version. And so what the synthetic data generator that we've built in R does is it generates students and it simulates them through their educational career from kindergarten through 12th grade and into college enrollment. And there are places where if you look closely, you can see that it's synthetic. But the idea is that it generates a lot of attributes that will give you pretty much the ability to do the entire college-going toolkit and a lot more. So there's things in there about special education status. There's demographic information about the students. They have an assessment history from grade 2 to grade 10. Their assessment history helps determine whether they graduate or go on to college. They go to colleges that are from the IPEDS data, publicly available post-secondary data. So these realistic touches make the data more useful. And the other thing that synthetic data really was a barrier for is synthetic data is too easy to use. Any of you can do your job if somebody gave you a clean data set where the students were normalized, one student per year, all the variables were labeled and there were no errors. The synthetic data generator can give you that, but it can also give you the messy tables of data that you need to bring together to do that in the first place, too. So for training purposes, for people on your team, to give people a clue what your work is, you can show them, like, we take data in these different pieces, and we have to put it together and then do our analysis. And that was always something that I thought was really critical to making something that's authentic to the work that education analysts do, is the data has to be generated in a way that is realistically messy, and is organized in the sort of chaotic fashion that student information systems sometimes organize data from an analytics perspective. So I think we've achieved that. And so, you can use the public data, and you can put out OpenSDP type materials. You can use your own data, and you can clean it so that it's not confidential anymore and put out analyses. Or you can use the synthetic data. And the best part about the synthetic data is you can tweak the synthetic data to look more like a community that you serve or work for. And that part is a little tricky right now. It's very hard to think through, but I'm hoping to work with you as a community to figure out what kinds of templates or parameters we need to feed the simulation to generate school districts or states that look like the students that you serve, because the best authentic synthetic data would be data that looks really close to what you have, but where you can control the parameters of the data. And so that's really the ultimate goal, and I would say in the alpha stage, we are at a place where it'd be really fun for you to try to achieve that and for us to work on that together. So that leads us into talking about how we want people to participate in SDP, in OpenSDP with us. And Miriam and I are going to walk through these participation use cases together.
So meet our cohort 8 fellow, Anise. Yes, thank you. Anise works for the Department of Education. New Mexico PED, and she wants to run the college-going diagnostics. She wants to run the code to use the tools that we have. How would she do that, Jared?
Well, she would go to the analysis page on the OpenSDP homepage, and she would look for the college-going analysis that's most interesting to her. She could then read the analysis right on the webpage to see if it's going to meet her needs. Then she can clone, download, or fork that code and data to her own computer. She can open it up. She can run it in R or Stata, whatever is her choice. And if she wants, she can make edits to it. She can see what other people have suggested to do with it. And then, once she's done that, she's got a feeling like, okay, I understand how this works. Then she can go through the part of the analysis where she figures out which of her local data elements map onto the data elements used in the code already, and then she can produce the same chart.
Right? So, I'm Shanna Ricketts. I don't know if you know Shanna, but she's a very savvy analyst. She always finds the little errors and the glitches, and she's found some big ones recently in the toolkit. And she wants to make those changes. She's also found a bunch of other questions that she's able to answer using the synthetic data set that we have. And she wants to help other people be able to answer those too. How does she do that?
She can go to our website and look at our code on GitHub. And using GitHub, she can fork the repository. So she now has her own copy of it on GitHub. She can make her changes, add her analysis, make sure it works and runs with the synthetic data, make a nice graph, explain the graph. Then she can put that on her GitHub to show the world. And then she can tell us at OpenSDP, hey, I'd like you to bring these changes into the main repository to share on the OpenSDP homepage and to highlight to the OpenSDP community. And then we can review it together and say, okay, these are great changes. Here's some little feedback that we think would make it a little easier. Approve her requests, bring it in, and instead of waiting to make PDFs or whatever, the whole thing will be updated on the website, and we now have her great contribution added for everyone in the community to use.
Now the toolkit is better.
And the toolkit gets better over time, yes.
Okay, I have Akeisha Jones. Where is Akeisha? She's sleeping. Okay, I don't know if you went to her session. Yes, yesterday, but she's doing some cool things with like proportionality and discipline. And I think a lot of you work with discipline data, and it's pretty important. I know maybe underutilized in a lot of ways that we need to start really using in the future. And we have nothing about that, really. We have no look at like equity and discipline on OpenSDP yet. We haven't created those resources, but she's done the work. So she wants to know, like, how can she help the community start analyzing these at scale so they can identify these gaps across the country? How does she do that?
She should put her stuff on GitHub. So she can go to GitHub and make a repository. She can put her code and her output on that GitHub. We have a template to show what a really easy way to make it like a really attractive website as your final output for either Stata or R. She should make sure that it can run on synthetic or publicly available data. So she could use publicly available disciplinary data so other people can replicate it locally, or she can synthesize her own local data and share that data out with people, or she can add a contribution to the data engine to allow it to have discipline data as well. Then she writes up her analysis like she already has and makes what we call a web guide, but is really just a collection of code, charts, and text describing what the process that you're doing, much like the toolkit already looks like. He can publish that up on her GitHub, let us know about it, and then she can share it with the wider OpenSDP community. So a lot quicker and easier than it would be today.
Yeah, I don't think it means like authoring a whole toolkit. It's like, it could be just like, how do you answer this one question? Like that's, it could be just like a discrete chunk of information. How do you like figure out this one particular gap? And sometimes like those discrete chunks are exactly what people are looking for. They're not looking for like the full gamut. How do I walk through the entire analyses? They just want to know, like, how do I answer this question and how do I get there faster so I can give this analysis to the people who need it most.
And the other benefit is that he can show it to people all around the country and say, hey, what do you think of this approach? Was there anything you would change? Is there any other way I could look at this problem? And they'd say, you know, I've been working on this problem for 6 months too. Let's get together and work on this and improve it and iterate together. That's what was missing before, and that's what Miriam talked about at the beginning.
Yeah, because maybe then Shannon Ricketts is like, that way you're doing that is a little weird. Maybe you should try this. And then she adds to your analyses, and it continues to grow. And it's also a way for you to get authorship, too. So, like, we want to recognize that this is all going to be, like, STP's brain trust. Like, you would become an author. You would have credit in that way. And it would be, like, your contribution to the greater education analytics community so that people know what kind of talent you are and can tap you for help across the country.
Great.
So just to summarize, like, here are things you can contribute to OpenSDP. Feedback on existing repositories, new repositories of code and analyses using synthetic data or public data, tutorials, you can add tutorials. So you can add to the synthetic data because it's dynamic, so like you can just keep building out the tables on these students so we can do more and more analyses about them. The sky's the limit. I think there are probably lots of other things that you can imagine sharing in a common place, and we want to know what those things are because we haven't thought of everything in the past couple of months, and we really think that maybe you have some ideas about like what you could share but haven't had a platform to share, or what you would want to see but haven't figured out where you could find something fast. And so that's why we want to kind of like get your feedback as the SDP community. So we want you to spend like a few minutes, 5 minutes, actually looking at the website in greater depth. We've been trying to walk you through it, but there's nothing like kind of navigating and reading and figuring things out for yourself. So hopefully you brought your laptops. If not, find a pal to peruse the website together and start kind of digging in. In about 5 minutes, I'll transition us to some questions. And we have about 5 questions we'd love you to discuss with your table. I'll walk you through each of those questions. We recommend you spend 5 on each, but you don't need to. And then at the end, we're going to give you the link to a survey where you can individually give us feedback on what you see the potential is, what the limitations are if you're not like a coder, for like why you would or wouldn't share this with your team or a friend, those sorts of questions that might be really more at like operating at that level. And then finally, like we'll wrap up and see if we got any great ideas in the crowd that we might be able to escalate as a team for the next version of this community tool. So with that, please go ahead. Here is the website, opensdp.github.io or bit.ly/opensdp, all lowercase. And spend a few minutes looking through and trying to figure out, like, what is it?
We don't tell you what we need. This is what it would look like. And then we would know these two.
Okay. We're actually at time, believe it or not. Thank you so much. I feel like I actually heard a couple really great ideas for things we can improve. And I was hoping I could get two great ideas for things that could be better, or like some future thinking idea that would improve this thing right now. And I was wondering if someone would be willing to share with me. Jason Becker. This is almost scary.
No, it won't be, I promise. So one thing we talked about at our table is like one of the most valuable parts of the toolkits is not at the level of the analysis, but it's actually reference implementation of business rules, and that's something more readily shared and easily used across things. So maybe the unit of work is not sharing an analysis as much as I think there's a lot of benefit to sharing reference implementation of the business rules with explanations around them.
Great. That's great. And one thing we try to do is make sure all of this is SEDS aligned, so we're hoping to release some resources about like, yeah, how do you format your data in a common way? That's a part.
Yeah, so I think one low-hanging fruit is to put up some data visualization or something around NWA data, because I'm sure many people in the room are familiar with it, and it's a common data file structure that exists everywhere. But two of the more complicated things for making it better, maybe to include spaces instead of just R and Stata or Tableau or other visualization software in SQL, and then tackling the potential problem of our student information systems not allowing us to share a certain table structure because it's proprietary, but maybe necessary in order to make good use of this.
Very interesting. Great. Is there one more urgent thing percolating? Alex Ferrier.
I think it'd be great to have some analysis templates for the publicly available data that you're linking to, you know, the Stanford data set, the data sets on the federal ed department website. It'd be really great to have those available where I could just put in my state's name and have an analysis that's generated.
No, I agree, and if anyone wants to build that or has ideas for that, let me know. As I was just saying to Andy Baxter and talking about with a couple of people, like, the good thing about open is, like, if it fails, it's your fault, right? no, but really, like, we do want to make this, like, usable and user-friendly, and we think there are tools that we're going to use no matter what in SDP fellowship training, so it's going to have legs. But we want it to be bigger and better and more, like, portable, as it were. So we hope you do fill out this feedback survey. It gives you a place to put your name in if you want to be involved in different ways, including, like, we want to do some real pressure testing, some real, like, guided feedback through the website and stuff. So if you're willing to, like, to work with us on that, we would be excited. If you want to be part of, like, a governance team that helps look for quality and, like, think about what should live in SDP, we'd, like, love to have extra voices in on that. Like, this is really meant to be a community endeavor. And so those of you who are so bold, like, come and find us, let us know that you're interested, and we'll bring you back into the community. But with that, we are at time. So I am going to release you to your next and, I think, last capstone session.